Hey, everybody. Good morning. We just want to let you know that we're having a little bit of difficulty getting live on Facebook this morning, so we'd invite you to join us on YouTube and hang in there. Thanks so much. If there was ever a time to sing about love, it's today, right? 2, 3. So much fun to have Pete and Gay with us this morning. We're going to do one of our favorite holiday classics from right this time of year.
Christ.
And now we say officially good morning and welcome to Columbine Spiritual Center. We're centered in God. Say it with me. We celebrate a world of harmony, peace, and abundance for all. I feel especially abundant this morning because we are welcoming back Pete Jacobs and Gay Waterbury as our special music guest artists. These guys are amazing pillars of our music team here, and we hope that they will open your hearts in the same way that they do ours all the time. Let's hear it for Gay and Pete.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you deliver will soon deliver you.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand?
Did you know your baby boy has walked where angels trod?
When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know?
The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The dumb will speak the praises of the baby boy would one day rule the nations. Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great
Pete and Gay. So great to have you with us this morning. So let's light our Christ candle. A little challenge with the light this morning, the technology this morning. Okay, one of these has got to work, right? Maybe not. Well, there we go. Okay, I better keep it going. And we're going to light our Advent wreath candles as we are in the third Sunday of Advent this morning. Won't you join me in prayer and take that deep breath and know that no matter what's going on, no matter what challenges we might have, that God is here, the Spirit is here. And so, sweet Spirit, this morning is all about love. Love. Love for ourselves, love for each other, love for all living things, love for God, love for Spirit, love for community. Love. That great harmonizing, unifying power that brings us all together. Grateful for that love. That divine love that just is always within in us, always enough, always longing to come forth and express. Even when, and maybe especially when, we see people hurting, we see people struggling, having challenges, and we hold everyone who may be challenged from the pandemic, from health challenges, mental health challenges, economic uncertainty, maybe due to loss of jobs or loss of income. Those that are struggling due to racial injustice. Those that are struggling due to whatever they're seeing out in the world that isn't love. Can leave a heaviness in our heart. And so, sweet Spirit, we hold ourselves and we hold everyone, every living being in this prayer, in this love space, in this heart connection, knowing that Spirit is there. That love is there. That love, no matter what's going on, has already won. We thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
Starlight shines, the night is still. Shepherds watch from a hill. I close my eyes, see the night when love was born. Perfect child gently waits. A mother bends to kiss God's face. I close my eyes, see the night when love was born. Angels fill the midnight sky. They sing. Thank you. Prince of Peace, love comes down for you and me. Heaven's gift, the holy spark to light the way inside our hearts. Bethlehem, through your small door came the hope we've waited for. The world was changed forevermore when love was born. Close my eyes, see the night when love was born.
Beautiful, Pete and Gay, when love was born. Or not. There's a story of a couple, married couple, who were having an argument, and they got to the point after a couple of days of the silent treatment. Anybody ever do that? The silent treatment? Until one evening, a husband realized that he needed his wife's help in getting up because he had an early morning flight. And so he wasn't sure how he was going to get her help because he didn't want to speak first. So he wrote her a note and said, "Please wake me at 5 a.m. Went to bed. The next morning he woke up, it was 9 o'clock in the morning. And he got out of bed and said, "Oh, she didn't wake me. We're still having this fight." And he was about to go in and start some other argument about that until he found a note next to his side of the bed on the nightstand that said, "It's 5 o'clock. Wake up." I love that story because the things we do for love are lack of love are crazy. But today is the third Sunday of Advent where we talk about love. Advent, of course, is this time where we're preparing for the birth of a new awareness of our Christ nature. The birth of Jesus represents that. And we're building our muscles and using these inner qualities that we have in order to get ready for that birth. We talked about faith and hope and how that was important to build that and take a look at where our beliefs are. We talked last week, Scott talked about peace in such a beautiful way, that peace is necessary in our heart to be in that calm place to allow this birth to happen. And today we're going to talk about love. So what is love? It's a loaded question. What is love? I put that question into Google, and do you know there were 10.5 billion posts on what is love? So many people have a different idea on what love is. He loves me, he loves me not, he loves me not. But there are many, many posts on what love, and a lot of them really come from a human type of love, not the kind of love that we want to really talk about today and more of the divine love. This is what the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary says about love. Love is a divine attribute. It is an idea in one mind. God is love, and love is God, or a quality in being. The difference between divine love and human love is that divine love is broad and unlimited. A universal and harmonizing power. Human love is based on personality and is selfish, lawless, and fickle. So that love, that quality of being love is within us. It's something that is innately in us. It's not like faith that we have to develop. It just is. It's a part of us. There's always enough of it. There's always enough to share. There's always enough to give. It's part of our innate essence. I love in the Advent booklet this year that one of the articles talks about a candle that when it's lit, its light is never diminished when it lights other candles. It still provides the same amount of light. We have so much more capacity to love than we think, but we put on human limitations on our love. I want to share with you a silly dream that I had a few nights ago. In this dream, and there's a purpose to this, but in this dream, I was at Columbine, and we had made an arrangement, and we had advertised, and we said, anybody who comes to our service today is going to get a free hot dog. Now, why a hot dog? I don't know why. Why a hot dog, but I was serving the hot dogs on a tray. And the last one I handed out, people were in their cars listening to the service. It wasn't this parking lot we have here, but a much bigger one. And the last hot dog I handed out to someone, the community member said, but where's the ketchup and mustard, Sue? And I said, no, I'm just serving hot dogs today. That's all, just hot dogs. And I was walking back because it was the last one on the tray. I need to refill my tray. And I look back to the parking lot, and the parking lot is packed with cars, people that wanted hot dogs. And so I went into the kitchen here at Columbine, and there were all these people renting the space and in the kitchen and in my way, and I couldn't get to the hot dogs. And I realized when I finally got to them, they were frozen. That we didn't anticipate so many people wanting a hot dog. And all these people were in my way, and I couldn't get to the microwave to warm them, to thaw them out. And then I woke up. And I love looking at my dreams, especially when they're very vivid like that, and trying to see, well, what meaning does this have for me? What meaning does this dream have for me? And I was thinking that food is nourishment to people. It can represent love. That all these people that had come to Columbine wanted love. They were feeling like they didn't have enough love. And we were trying to provide them with this love. But something was blocking my ability to get that hot dog, to get those hot dogs. Something was blocking it. Some people or some thoughts in my mind were not allowing me to get to that love place in my heart. And when I finally did get to them, they were frozen. I was putting my own limitations on being able to share love, being able to love others, maybe being able to love myself. And so I thought, as I was running the next day after this dream, you know, love is the main course. Love is the main thing. It doesn't require, we may have preferences around it that it needs ketchup and mustard or relish or whatever. But it's the main course. It's the meat of the meal. It's like the climax or the apex of the meal. It's the main course is the most important part of the meal. And then everything else that goes with it is to enhance that. It's the center. So I was thinking, what keeps our hearts frozen over? What thoughts, what conditions keep us from being able to share this love, of which there was abundant supply in the freezer, I just couldn't get to them. And then I needed to warm them up. I love this article that I read by Roger Gabriel, who writes for Chopra.com, Deepak Chopra's website. He says this: love is eternal, infinite, and unbounded until we try to contain it within the limitations of our personal needs. Think of pure love like a vast, endless ocean flowing effortlessly in all directions. When we impose our likes and dislikes on it, it's like freezing parts of the ocean, so ice blocks form. Love then assumes various forms to satisfy our needs. However, when our love becomes unconditional, the warmth of that love melts the ice and we enjoy the fullness of pure love. You see, those ice blocks are what block us from experiencing this unconditional love. We put up conditions. We put up judgments, or we put up having to have things my way, or could be we want to control things, or we're afraid that somebody won't love us, and so we withhold our love. But love, as that main course, needs no conditions, needs no condiments, needs no side dishes. It just nourishes us. I love doing a play on words. So main, the main course, love is the main course. Main means vital or crucial or primary or basic. And course, think of course not as a food course, but as the way, as in chart a new course, or the process, the journey, or the system, or the program. And so love as a main course takes on new meaning because it's the way of life. Love should be the crucial, the vital way that we live our lives. It's so important to our peace of mind to live from this place of love. 2020, this year, has certainly had a lot of challenges. And it's been difficult for some, for me included, sometimes to keep my heart open as I'm reading news articles about the divide in our country, as I'm seeing people hurting and grieving over losing lost loved ones, as I'm seeing relationships feeling strained. And to be honest, with all this quarantine, Kevin and I, my husband and I, have had a tough time too, like many of you. And so a few weeks ago, we both started reading a book and decided that this was really important to us to have these conversations. And we started reading a book that a guy from one of his men's groups recommended called The Seven Levels of Intimacy by Matthew Kelly. And in the book, Matthew Kelly says, love is a choice, not necessarily a feeling, that we choose to love. We choose to look for the good. We choose to see beyond those little things that irritate us or annoy us. We choose to stay in this place of love. And that the main purpose of relationship in our lives is to bring out the best version of ourselves and the best version of each other. Now, not all relationships will get through these seven levels. Not all relationships in our lives are meant to be at all seven levels of intimacy. Some just get to levels one or two. But our primary relationships in our lives could be a close friend, could be a spouse or a partner or a loved one or a sibling or child or parent, whatever it is for you, that we need to have these conversations. Communication is vitally important. And this book that Kevin and I both read on our own has brought about a lot of conversations to help us better understand each other and better love each other. And it's been a wonderful practice. We're not done yet. There's a lot more conversation to have. And as human beings, we're constantly evolving and growing and changing, and so the conversations need to continue. If these relationships are important to us in our lives, we need to make them a priority. Bring out the best version of ourselves in this lifetime so that we can encourage and bring out the best version in people we care about. Instead, we often think, what's in it for me with a relationship? What's in it for me? What can I get out of this? Instead of, what can I give? Where are those ice blocks? That's an ice block right there. What can I get instead of what can I give? So I've been thinking, what ice has formed over my heart? What's been in my way of expressing more love, of being the best version of myself? What am I afraid of? And I think one of the things, there could be a lot. One of the things is that you won't see me the way I want you to see me, that you won't see me as God sees me. Who does? Other than God himself or herself, other than spirit. But we put up those blocks because of that fear. I noticed I've done that. Feeling like there's not enough, that I'm not enough, that I don't matter enough. Matthew Kelly says this in The Seven Levels of Intimacy. We are afraid to be ourselves. We are afraid that if people really knew us, they wouldn't love us. This is the deepest of all human fears lurking in the heart of every person. You know, we are most lovable when we are our vulnerable selves, when we stop pretending that we've got it all together, when we stop pretending that we know everything and what's going on and what's going on with us, when we just stop the pretense and just be ourselves. We want people to love us, warts and all, but we're afraid to show those warts. But when we do put down that guard and just be ourselves, we find that others can relate to us a whole lot more, and that we're free. We're free. This isn't easy to do. It's not an easy thing at all. We put conditions up. We put up judgments. But that's human love. That's a human love from a human perspective, not divine love. Divine love just loves for the sake of loving. And any time that we judge someone or we put up conditions to our love or conditions to our forgiveness, we are stopping our own flow of life, our own flow of love. We are not in alignment with the truth of who we are. We are not in alignment with our source. We're not in alignment with spirit. We're not in alignment with anyone. We're out of the flow. And we forget that there's always enough hot dogs. There's always enough love to share. It's endless. It never diminishes. It never depletes itself. When love is the main course, the lens through which we see things, we can still see the hardship in the world, but we also see the love in the world. We also see the good in the world, the loving. We know that we are loved, lovable, and loving always. that opportunity is always there for us to express from that. And when we are in alignment with that, we have a clearer vision. We have 20/20 vision. We have a spirit. We are seeing through a spiritual lens. It's like we've cleaned the window and removed all that grime, and we can see clearly what love is telling us. I mentioned a couple weeks ago that I've been really enjoying studying Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene, of course, a woman from the Christian scriptures. And I have been reading a couple books about her. Mary Magdalene saw with the eyes of the heart. There's a gospel according to Mary Magdalene that was found years after, in the late 1800s. Three copies of it were found. And in her gospel, the gospel according to Mary Magdalene, she is mocked in her own gospel by the other apostles. But she is not put off by that, because she knows that her worth has nothing to do with the love that she feels and the love that she's able to express, because she's never felt separate from that love. You and I, we feel separate from that love at times. And that's when we're cutting the flow. That's when we think we've run out of hot dogs. In the Mary Magdalene Revealed book by Megan Watterson, she says this: love is within us. We are love. And we don't have to earn or prove or deserve this fact. And if we can recognize that we've never been separate from it and bring it forth outside of us, this is what saves us. This is what saves us from a life that feels empty or isolated or disconnected. This will save us because we know that that love is always part of us, always ready for us to clean that window and see more clearly that is part of us. We need to align with that love. You know, on December 21st, we're having the Great Conjunction. Did I say that right? Conjunction, yes. The Great Conjunction, where you may have read an article about it, where Jupiter and Saturn will align with the sun, between the Earth and the sun, and they will come together and look like one big bright planet. And this happens on December 21st, on the winter solstice. It hasn't happened, and we haven't been able, their orbits every 20 years align. But we haven't been able to see them this close with the human eye since the 1200s, 1226, I believe. So almost 800 years. It's quite the phenomenon that from this vantage point, from here, we can see these two planets align. And what happens when they come together? They're the brightest thing in the sky. What happens when we align with our source? As those planets are aligning with the sun, we align with the sun, S-O-N, that begotten Son of God, of which we are a unique expression. And when we align with that, we can align with anyone, no matter how close or far away they are from us, but we can align with them and create a brighter light. You know, in actuality, it will look like these two planets are right on top of each other, but they're actually 407 million miles apart. It's just that they're from our perception, from our vantage point, they will appear to be right next to each other. It's really quite incredible. But this is how it is with us, that when we align with that, source of our being. When we align with love, our light shines so bright in incredible ways. With that lens, we can be the best version of ourselves, and we can bring out the best version in others. I watched a movie the other night on Friday that Carolyn Richardson recommended. Thank you, Carolyn. It's a documentary on Amazon Prime, and it was called The Antidote. Now, don't make the mistake of going to Prime and saying, watch Antidote, because you will get a movie about an awful skin disease. You have to say The Antidote. And in this movie, The Antidote, are just incredibly touching stories of people helping people, people loving people. They say in the movie, whenever we think that someone's life is not as valuable as ours, or someone's life is more valuable than someone else's, we're cut off from the flow of love. We're cut off from the flow of life. And we're not expressing from that best version of ourselves. And in this movie, you see people caring for each other. You see a group of people inviting homeless in to soak their feet and take care of their feet. You see a community of elders and foster children living together and taking care of each other and feeding each other. You see students in a public school taking a required world religions class to help them learn about different cultures and different people. You see a group of Black people trying to have a neighborhood bike repair shop where they work on fixing bikes and then selling them or loaning them, and all the people that donate their bikes to give people transportation to get to a job interview or to go see a family member. And you see a woman who just graduated from college because the first in her family to graduate from college, breaking that cycle of generational poverty because she got educated. It's incredibly touching to watch this movie and see how we can align with love, how we can align with that best version of ourselves and help other people with love. We can drop those barriers, thaw that ice, and warm our hearts as well as the hearts of other people, and let love be the main course. So how do we do this? How do we express that divine love? Well, we have to put it into action. We have to do something with it. I Googled that too, how to show love. There was about 8 billion posts on that too. But I love how we can just keep it simple. Kevin and I bought a few books for our grandchildren for Christmas, and they were recommended on Oprah's Favorite Things in the Oprah magazine this year. And they're books for children. This particular one is called A Kid's Book About Empathy. They have a kid's book about shame and kid's book about racism, kid's book about optimism and belonging, and a whole bunch of them. And I love how in this book, A Kid's Book About Empathy by Darren K. Roberts, he says, he keeps it very simple to tell children, how can we be empathetic towards our friends? Say your friend just lost a pet. And he tells the children in the book, 4 steps, take a deep breath. We can do this too. Don't be in a rush to tell someone how you feel. Ask them how they feel. 2, listen. Focus on them instead of focusing on what we want to share. Let them speak first. Listen. 3, ask questions. Use more question marks than periods. This is how we start to understand. And 4, imagine how they feel. Put yourself in their shoes. He says this is how we can feel with someone. Empathy is feeling with someone instead of feeling for someone as sympathy would. Feeling with someone is a great way to show someone that you love them, to allow them to be who they are. And in the process, we are the best version of ourselves. When love is the main course in our lives, we become that best version. And we invite and encourage others to be their best version as well. So I invite you this week to serve up more love. Not necessarily hot dogs. I don't know why hot dogs were the food for Boulder, Colorado. Doesn't make sense. But serve up more love, more conjunction with communities and align with that love. It's a tall order. But there is so much love in each of you. I know you can do this, that we all can do this. And let love be our main course. So I want to invite you into a time of meditation. Gently close your eyes if you're in a good place in your home to do that, and take that deep breath. And I want you to focus on these words from the first book of Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 4-8. You've probably heard this before. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. So as we focus on those words, bring to mind this question and then answer, I don't know, and allow your consciousness to go wherever spirit wants it to go. How can you let love be the main course in your life? We'll pause on that and rest together in the silence. Bless and appreciate and gratefully receive your love offerings. We are so grateful for this community that is very generous and giving, and we are just so grateful for every donation that comes here and helps us do what we, our mission to do, which is inspire personal transformation. So let's say our offertory blessing together. God's love has always met and will always meet all my needs. I give freely, I receive abundantly, and I am grateful. Amen. So it is. So if you're here for the first time or you haven't signed up for our email list and would like to, I want to invite you to go to our website, columbineunity.org, and there is a button you can click as you scroll down just a little bit and to get on our email list. We would love for you to be on there so you can know what's going on here. We send out an email every Thursday late afternoon and every Sunday morning, and you can just know what's coming up and what we have going on here. So go ahead and go to that if you want to get on our mailing list. We're having two Christmas Eve services. If you've been on our mailing list and seen the emails, then you'll know that we have two services coming up. We're going to do an outdoor service where we're going to be outside on the lawn. You can be in your cars listening through FM radio. And it's going to be a simple service with the Christmas story, metaphysical interpretation, Christmas carols, and just really sweet time to spend together. That's at 4:30 on Christmas Eve. And then afterwards, we're going to, the production team and staff will be coming inside and providing a virtual service for you at 6:00. And we hope that you will tune in or join us in one or both of those services. You can go to the website if you want to join the live service, the outdoor service, and sign up so that we have an idea on how many people are planning to attend. We'd appreciate knowing that. And please bring, when you come on Christmas Eve or before, we have the bin now, we're doing a coat drive for Sister Carmen. Any warm, gently used or new coats, hats, mittens, gloves, scarves, socks, to help those that are feeling this cold that we're experiencing right now. Please provide that and put it in the bin that's at the front door. And we have an activity going on right now with our youth that Jeannie Oliver Ray has set up for us. You can come out and with your families and paint. The paints are out there. Everything's out there that you need. And light a battery-operated tea candle, tea light. Put that on the altar and have it be a special time for you and your children. We would love for you to do that. It's out by the playground. There is no service this afternoon due to the snow, the weather, the cold, and we hope that to have one next Sunday as well. And if you want to join our Zelloship, that's our fellowship over Zoom, please sign up. There's a new link. It's in the e-bulletin that went out this morning at 12:15, and have some connection time with people that are also on there, on that Zelloship. Is that it? That's it.
I think that's it. Thanks, everybody. If you want to join us to sing our peace song, feel free to stand up or just keep on hanging out in that recliner. And then we'll finish with a little more about love.
Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
Amen.
We're going to take you out with All You Need Is Love again, since we know some of you might have missed it this morning. We love you. Have a beautiful week.